Hi, I'm Dr. J, and this is a video about statistics. Last time in the first video in this series, we talked about statistics as a field of study. And that field of study is really all about data and analyzing data, presenting data, organizing data, and so forth. Now we're going to talk about statistics as the sort of formal definition of when we say mean, median, and mode, what are we talking about? And so the very quick definition is that a statistic is just any function of data, right? So in a previous stat course, you probably, or a previous video, you've heard about the mean, you've figured out how to calculate the mean, right? That's just a function of that data. Same thing with median and mode and quantiles and quartiles and percentiles and right? Lots of things are statistics of the data. Whenever you're getting a number out of that data, that's a statistic. All right, so we just talked about a bunch of those: sample mean, sample median, sample mode, sample quantile, sample variance, sample standard deviation are a whole set of examples. And these fall under a category called descriptive statistics. That is, they're in some way describing your data. Okay. Now, we talked in the previous video about a desire to make inferential statements about a population. And so when we have a statistic that's trying to make a statement about a population parameter, then that statistic will often refer to as an estimator, because it is estimating that population parameter. Okay, and so we're going to go today and look at a few different examples of estimators, what the population parameter is, what the statistic is that provides us the estimate of the population parameter. All right, so we call that an estimator. So here's an example. Right? Hopefully you've seen a sample mean before, maybe you haven't seen it written like this, but we're going to suppose now that we have a random sample from some population. That population has a distribution that's defined by the mean here, it's mu, and a variance that's sigma squared. Right? So all the observations of the population have that same mean and same variance, and we're going to assume independence amongst those units. So if you don't know what independence is, you probably should go click on the video up here and learn about independence. All right, and now we're going to take the sample mean of these observations. We're going to write the sample mean in this way. So x bar, that's the common way that statisticians will write the sample mean. That sample mean you just calculate by adding up all the individual samples that you have, all the individual data points that you have. Those are the x1, x2, x3, up to xn. And that's, if you haven't seen it before, that's what this big summation symbol means, just to add up all of those x's. And then you divide by the number of observations you have. That's the n. That is the definition for the sample mean. And when we have that sample mean from this random sample from a population where the observations, where the individual observations are assumed to be independent and they all have a common mean, then it turns out that this sample mean is an estimator of the population mean. That population mean was up here. That's the expectation of these random variables. That's the value mu. It's unknown, but we're going to estimate it. And when we use this sample mean as an estimator of that population mean, sometimes we write it in a different way. And that is we write mu hat. Okay, so anytime you see that hat or that caret symbol above a Greek letter in particular, then that quantity is the estimator of that population parameter. All right, so that was a sample mean. We can do another one. We can do the sample variance. So we have the same exact setup, but now instead of the sample mean, we will calculate the sample variance. The sample variance is right here. Oftentimes, it is denoted capital S squared. Here we have out in front the ratio 1 over n minus 1. So this is something you have to remember if you're trying to calculate the sample variance as opposed to the sample mean. The sample mean just had 1 over n. The sample variance has 1 over n minus 1. Okay, and now what we're going to do is we're going to add up all the observations where we've taken the observations, we've subtracted the mean that we calculated on the previous slide. We subtracted the mean and then we square it. So we have sort of this deviation for each sample from the mean. We take all those, we add them up, that's that big summation symbol, and then we divide by n minus 1. And that's called the sample variance. All right, this sample variance, as you might suspect, is an estimate of the population variance. Okay, there's the estimate of the population variance. And when we use it to estimate that population variance, we'll often write sigma squared hat, right? That hat indicating that it's an estimator of the population variance. There's the second formula here that you might have seen, and that second formula is a quicker way. Basically, it just derives from the first formula, but a quicker way to calculate that sample variance. Here now, all you need to do is calculate the sum of the observations squared and add those up. And once you have that, then you can calculate the rest of the quantity. Okay. Now, this is a sample variance, but we have a sample standard deviation. So the sample standard deviation is just the square root of the sample variance. And that, of course, estimates the population standard deviation. All right, the next one on the list is quantiles. You might have heard of quantiles before, but a quantile is just a number in X such that the probability of a random variable X being less than that value X is less than or equal to P, and the probability that the random variable X is greater than that value little x is less than or equal to 1 minus P. And so the intuition here is that that value X just splits the population into a proportion p on one side and a proportion 1 minus p on the other side. Now, we also have a sample quantile. And the sample quantile has exactly the same idea, but now we have our finite sample and we're going to split it, right, at some value, x on this x-axis, such that we have a p proportion of our sample on one side and 1 minus p on the other side. You might have heard these quantiles referred to as percentiles. Basically, a percentile just takes the quantile value and multiplies it by 100. So we might say the 95th percentile, and that is the 0.95 quantile. So they're exactly the same thing, just multiplied by 100. You might have heard of quartiles. So quartiles just mean we're going to break the data up into four pieces. And so we're going to break it up into 25% below the first quartile, 25% between the first and second, 25% between the second and third, and 25% above the third quartile. So when you're breaking the data set up into four parts, you're gonna actually have three numbers to do that, the first, second, and third quartiles. Okay. Now, sometimes we give that second quartile, or often really, a specific name. We call that the median. So that median is the second quartile, which is also the 0.5 quantile and the 50th percentile. Now, all of these sample quantiles estimate the corresponding population quantile. Another use of these sample quantiles and population quantiles are for something called the interquartile range. That's just the third quartile minus the first quartile. We can do that both for the population and we can do it for the sample. And of course, the sample interquartile range is an estimate of that population interquartile range. As a visual demonstration of these quantiles, or these quartiles, really, we can talk about, say, the standard normal distribution. If you're not familiar with the normal distribution, you might want to check on the slide, the video up here. Here on this bell-shaped curve, the probability density function for a standard normal distribution, we've drawn three vertical dashed lines. Those three vertical dashed lines are the quartiles for a standard normal. So yes, although visually it might not look like it, it's true that we have, to the left of that first line, we have 1/4 of the area under the curve, right? That area is 0.25. Between the first two dashed lines, we have another area of 0.25, or 25% of the total area. Between the second and third, another 25%. And to the right of that last dashed line, we have another 1/4 of the total area under this curve. Right, so those are the population quartiles. Now let's take a sample. Suppose we took a sample of 1,000 observations. That's demonstrated using this histogram. So this histogram, notice it doesn't look as clean as that bell-shaped curve, and that's because we only have a sample and not the whole population. Now the vertical red solid lines are the sample quartiles. So those are the sample quartiles, and you can see that they're close to the population quartiles, those dashed lines, but they're not exactly the same. In particular, this sample looks to be a little bit shifted to the right compared to the standard normal true quartiles. But that's how it is when you have a sample. Now, the next video is going to talk about some properties of these statistics and of the estimators when those statistics are trying to estimate population parameters. We'll talk about things like unbiasedness, consistency, talk about standard error, and so forth. So, hope to see you there.